What is general aviation? It's recreational and personal flying. It's flight training, like the flight school that that Helen runs. It's corporate aviation. I fly for a corporation. We fly a corporate jet out of Easton. It's medical transport, sightseeing, business travel, aerial application, pest control, firebombing, that kind of thing. On-demand taxi charter. You can pick up the phone and you can call a charter operator and they will pick you up at the nearest airport and take you anywhere in the world you'd like to go if you've got the money. A nice way to travel if you can afford it. Aerial photography and advertising. You've seen banner tows at the beach. That's all part of GA. Law enforcement flies aircraft. Search and rescue is another big one, generally run by counties. And charity and public benefit flights. So that's a pretty good representation of some of the GA aircraft that are out there flying around. The one in the foreground there, the front, is a little two-place trainer made by Cessna. And as you can see, as you move further aft, you get into the world of the corporate jet. So we cover a lot of territory. We also have aircraft that are built by home builders, and it comes to them in a kit. And that's the most popular. There's about now, I think, the last time I looked at the counter, almost 9,000 just from this manufacturer alone. This is Vans Aircraft, and the most popular kit. And I put this pit and pole in here because I thought for sure he would be here. But down at Kentmore, just down the road, there's a retired airline pilot that built this camper here. It's called a pit and pole air camper from scratch. And it has a Model A or a Model B Ford engine in it. And that's the radiator sticking up there. And they all they do is get plans, and then they go out and buy the lumber and build them. So there's some really, really talented and dedicated folks out there. So if you're going to get a license, you can fly just about anything that you can conceive of. Everything from the upper left-hand corner there is a balloon. Right next to it, I've got a jet. They get ex-military jet trainers that come on the market, and folks fly those. We've got here some ex-military trainers. There's Helen's airplane. If you want to go splash and dash, you're going to get a if you come the third or fourth. In March, I think it is, right?
March 9th.
There's going to be a whole discussion on the autogyros, which is fascinating. I can't wait to see that. Gliders, you can tow gliders. You can see construction that they use the helicopters for. Remember when we had the Ebola scare and they went over to Africa and picked up some Americans and brought them back? It was an airplane just like this that they put a special package in there so that they could completely isolate the patient on the airplane and flew him back to the States. All of these aircraft here would require some kind of license issued by the FAA. And then we can get into aircraft that weigh less than 250, or no more than 254 pounds, and we call them ultralight aircraft, and they are self-regulated. You can go out and buy one of these things, and you get together with someone who knows how to fly them and enjoys teaching in them, and you can get your go out and fly these without any licensing whatsoever. I love this one here, where we've combined a hang glider with a boat, and that's that's probably one of the neatest hang gliders I've seen here.
There's a couple similar ones in this area. There's actually three.
Yeah, you see them splashing out there.
Yeah, those ones aren't ultrawide, though. They have a second seat.
Oh, do they?
Ultrawide aircraft all have single seats in there, but there's a couple of them that are licensed aircraft in there that are two-seat flying boats, quite literally, around here. Mm.
Anything to add to that one, Helen? If it isn't fun, we're not going to be involved.
I try to avoid the birds personally.
This is a fascinating project. I think it was the whoopee crane, wasn't it?
Yeah, it started off with geese in there, and that's the geese, the goose man there.
These are geese here.
But that was the initial experiment, but the Fish and Wildlife Service still has some crew that helps them out with the whooping cranes.
So what they actually do is they take the chicks, and they get the chicks to bond to the machine when they're young, and when it's time to migrate, they lead them to south, to the migration areas that they want them to habitat. Fascinating program. We also love to get together and compete. Well, after the pancakes and a safety seminar or so,
leftover pancake batter.
We'll hop in the airplane and the flower that we have left. You can see the circle painted on the runway. This is the window open to an airplane, and you would see a hand come out here with a bag of flour, and they'd fly about 500 feet and they'd try to put it in that circle. Just some of the fun things we do. We do spot landing contests. That's a chalk line across the runway. We see who can get the closest to that line. And they do that from a 180-degree position of beam. You take the engine aircraft, the aircraft to idle, so you can't use power to drive to that line. And it's all an energy management competition and a lot of fun. This is a phrase that we hear a lot, the $100 hamburger. Load the airplane up with friends and take off and go explore restaurants. And as you can see here, there's a book that guides us to the best places. Yeah.
You're now a fellow seaplane pilot. You know that we don't do $100 hamburgers around here.
That's right.
We do $100 crab cakes.
Yeah, $100 crab cakes, yes. Helen was checking me out in her seaplane, and we pulled up right on the beach, and the restaurant was right there. It was pretty neat. So we're just going to briefly touch on airports for general aviation aircraft, and you can start with a field like this. And again, this is part of that program where they're bonding with these geese. As he pushes this across the field, the wings start flapping, and they get used to that, and then they'll bring the ultralight in, and they'll start taxiing the ultralight around the field. And the geese will start to follow it, and when they're ready to fly and they're ready to take them south, off they go. Quite an interesting project. We have grass strips that we fly into. They are airports, chartered airports. And this is an example of the website page, opening page for Campbell Field, and they were famous for their soup on Sunday. So we all fly in for soup on Sunday. Wonderful thing about Campbell is he's incredibly pilot friendly. He has a crew car there, so when you arrive, you can sign up, grab the crew car, go into town, tour the area. And this is the southern neck, western shore of Virginia. We can also sleep at the airport if we want. Grab a tent and turn it into a fly-in hotel. And if you want to get really fancy, you can bring your airport to your house or bring your house to the airport, as it might. But the Spruce Creek is one of the most popular, most famous fly-in airports. That's a former Navy training base. And some enterprising entrepreneur bought that and the land and developed it. And all the folks that live there can take their airplanes from their house and taxi down the road to the runway, and off they go. And they have everything from an ultralight to a to a jet, small jets that are based based there. That's an example of a hangar that's attached to the house. So that's total immersion in aviation right there.
And you know,
it makes most of us very jealous.
The Kentmore Air Park happens to be the very first of these live-in airports in the country.
In the country?
In the country, yeah.
Is that right?
Right here on Kent Island.
We've got a picture of Kentmore.
Yeah.
Before we get to Kentmore, though, I'll take you to this
that's
one.
That's not just Kentmore.
Just to give you a feel. If you take a look at that house, to the right of the main house there is a big airplane. It's a Boeing, I believe it's a 720. And to the left is a corporate jet, and that's actually this guy's house.
That's what I thought.
Look familiar?
John Travolta's house.
John Travolta's house, and that's him on his seven, his big Boeing. Helen was telling me that he acquired that as compensation. Is that right?
Compensation. If he was
for an ad that he did.
Yeah, he was a spokesman for one of the other airlines in there, and they gave him an airplane in return for his payment. So.
Anybody recognize that young lady? Angelina Jolie. Yeah, she flies. How about
Harrison
this guy?
Ford.
Yeah, Harrison Ford is very, very active in aviation, owns a number of aircraft, and is a spokesman.
Not just the Millennium Falcon.
Right. Yeah. I don't know what Helen's talking about. I don't know anything about that.
He lands in golf courses.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. Kentmore, which Helen mentioned, is just down the road, just south of us. So all of these houses right here have hangars. Most of them have hangars, and that's the airport that they operate out of. That's their runway. This is typical. This would be a typical GA airport in the U.S. Wouldn't be unusual to see right here a cut through here, and you'd have seaplanes operating out of there. And if you had an amphib, you could taxi it and bring it down here and do maintenance on it. We have a setup similar to that over at Essex Sky Park, which is just south of Martin State. And there's over 5,200 of these guys in the U.S. Just by contrast, about one-tenth of that airlines serve about 560 airports in the U.S. So we're by far the most active in aviation. Then the runways get very small occasion. If a pilot can think of something fun to do, they're going to do it. That's a great show. So just to kind of contrast as an intro to airplanes and GA airplanes, if we compared them to an automobile, we can go anywhere from 254 pounds, again, in the ultralight world, up to thousands of pounds. But an aircraft like this Mooney here would be in the 3,000 pound area, somewhere in there would be typical. A four-place airplane, it would have a four-cylinder engine, just like the many of our automobiles do. About 160 horsepower, again, very similar to an automobile. The engines are primarily air-cooled. However, I have to acknowledge Helen, because she'll say a lot of the light sports here that have an engine that is both air and water-cooled. Front-wheel drive. We have a propeller, and that's the front of the airplane, so we have front-wheel propulsion on an airplane as well, to draw a parallel. Seating, our GA aircraft run anywhere from two to, one, but primarily, generally you'll find two to any six seats, which would be very similar to your automobile. Most do not have air conditioning, although Helen was probably the first to bring an air-conditioned airplane to this airport with her RV, And she has, if you go next door, you'll see a refrigerator, and it has a sign on it, and it has a box of ice in there. And an ingenious system where you drop a box of ice in there, add a little water, it has a little pump, and you stick it behind the two seats in her training airplane with a nice vent that blows cool air on you. So she has one of the only, I think, air-conditioned airplanes.
I have to have luxurious seating for my pilot.
At this airport.
You know?
Oh, is that? but normally we don't need AC because we climb and we go up, and it's much cooler up there, and it's not necessarily heated.
Or we fly a seaplane and we can just jump out in our bathing
suits.
Yeah,
there you go. Let's see. We got four wheels on a car. Our aircraft would generally equipped with three wheels. One wheel will be either in the nose or in the tail of the airplane, and one on each wing. In a car, the fuel is generally carried in a tank in the back. In an aircraft, we carry fuel in the wings, and it can be anywhere from 10 gallons to over 100 gallons. When you get into the corporate jet, I carry about 1,500 gallons. In the corporate jet I fly, it only costs me, what, $7,500 to fill it? That's a whole other world of GA. Let's see, what else did we have on here that I missed? Lighting. Car has headlights. We'll generally have a landing taxi light in the nose or on the wing. Car would have parking lights. We all know the parking light position on our automobile. On the aircraft, we have what we call navigation lights. The other thing is we like candy and Cokes. So you can buy your own Coke, but I'll give you a piece of candy. If you can tell me what color the light is on the left wing tip.
Green.
Green, very good.
It's just like a boat, right?
Just like a boat. The boats copied us. Okay, we came up with starboard is green, port is red.
Common of voting, though, John.
Absolutely does.
I mean, you make a lot of comparisons with cars here, obviously, but I honestly think that airplanes have a lot more in common with boats. You know, one of the biggest differences between airplanes and cars, but the similarity of boats, is with a boat, you can buy a canoe or you can buy a yacht. And that tends to hold very much true with airplanes, too, in there. You can buy very inexpensive airplanes. You've got a Cessna 150. How much is your Cessna 150 worth?
I had a, it was 24 when I bought it. Yeah.
You know, that's a very modestly priced airplane. How much is your jet worth? Not your jet, but the one you fly?
A couple million, yeah.
You know, and that's a lot more on par with how boats are. We can certainly buy, most cars are going to be somewhere between, $15,000 to $30,000. There's not a huge range in there. But with boats there are, and with cars and with airplanes there are too. And also, just a lot of the rules of the road that we deal with aviation are very similar to boaters. Boaters then transition to aviation pretty well because there's a lot of similarities.
How many have read their owner's manual from cover to cover in their automobile? Pretty rare, isn't it? You generally go to the owner's manual when you can't figure out you can't operate it properly in your car, and you dive into the manual to figure it out. By contrast, those of us who fly airplanes know the manual very, very well. I put a 63 Chevy up there. How many 63 Chevys do you see on the road? Not many, right? You got to go to a car show generally to see them.
Or Cuba.
Or Cuba, that's right, or Cuba. By contrast, you'll see a lot of 67 model aircraft out there flying. It's all primarily attributed to the way they're maintained and the rules that govern the condition of our airplane. Also, the training and so forth is significantly different. Probably the biggest advantage, one of the huge advantages for us, is versus an automobile is we can get away from this situation. This is a 8-mile backup in China. So that's our version of crossing the Bay Bridge. And one of the really wonderful things about being able to fly an airplane is look down and see all that traffic backed up and do this, except when you've got a really strong headwind in a little airplane and the cars are passing you on the highway. But the maintenance that is required on the aircraft is all governed by the FAA instructions, and we are required to annually pull our airplane apart, and it's got to be inspected by an FAA designated inspector for an annual inspection. If we're flying it commercially, we've got to have 100-hour inspections done on it, which is equivalent to the annual inspection. Anybody drive around with a check engine light on, for example? You don't do that in airplanes.
Those 100-hour inspections, for example, yeah. At my flight school in the summertime when we're busy, we're doing one of them almost every month. Yeah, where we're completely dismantling this airplane, going through all the parts and pieces, replacing anything with any signs of wear, and then reassembling the aircraft.
Is it a certain number of hours?
Every 100 hours it's required. Okay. Yeah. For an airplane that's either in commercial service when they're, and the commercial's not just airlines, but commercial is, in this case, banner towing, fish spotting, yeah. Power line patrol, or else used for flight instruction like my fleet.
Well, let's just look at the components of an airplane. Wing, empennage, we call it tail feathers, and we have a vertical stabilizer and a horizontal stabilizer, landing gear, and the power plant. Those are the basic components to an airplane. But what makes this thing fly? If you tell me magic on an exam, I'll probably be perfectly happy. May ask you a few more in-depth questions, but it really is remarkable.
Most people probably understand that on an airplane, the wings are what allows it to fly, while the propeller or jet engines drive it forward. This is a good base of knowledge for your average Joe. However, a pilot should know there's much more to it than just that. In total, there are four forces that act on an airplane while in flight. These four forces are lift, thrust, weight, and drag. We'll start with lift and work our way from there. Now, the wing itself doesn't generate lift. It's more about the shape of the wing. The wing is shaped like an airfoil. In normal forward flight, wind passing over the wing, called relative wind, is what helps the airfoil generate lift. When air is moving across the airfoil, it is forced to move faster across the top than it is along the bottom. The slower moving air across the bottom puts more pressure upwards on the wing than the faster moving air across the top. This in turn creates lift. This is known as Bernoulli's principle. So while the wings are creating the force of lift, which is pulling the aircraft up, we also have the force of thrust pulling the aircraft forward. This is created by the propeller. So you can say that lift and thrust are two forces helping the airplane fly. Now let's look at the other side of that, the two forces that counteract these two. Those forces would be weight and drag. First, we'll look at weight.
Okay, any questions so far? Pretty basic.
The material used to build this aircraft, along with the pilot and baggage weight, known as payload, and the fuel weight, all make up gross weight. Gross weight, along with gravity, all act as weight pulling down on the aircraft. In order for an airplane to fly, the lift generated by the wings must be equal to or greater than the weight of the aircraft.
So, as the weight changes here, the performance of the aircraft will change. And we have categories. The light sport is limited to 1,320 pounds. Once you get beyond the light sport, the sky's the limit in terms of weight. So that would be the cutoff.
Opposite of thrust is drag. Drag is created simply by the aircraft's existence. An object's natural desire to resist moving through a fluid such as air or water.
Have you ever stuck your hand out the window? We don't. Our windows are up now, but when I was young, you better have the window down or you're going to be pretty warm. And you fly with your hand. When you go flat plate, it'll take your arm off, won't it? You're dealing with the same kind of form drag with an airplane, and that's the drag they're describing there. Just the movement of the aircraft through the air or against the air.
Let's recap. Lift is the force created by the airfoil shape of the wing. Gravity, along with the gross weight of the aircraft, acts as a weight pulling down. The lifting force pulling up must be equal to the weight pulling down in order for an aircraft to fly. Thrust is produced by the propeller or jet engine pulling air through the system and moving the aircraft forward, thus creating more lift on the airfoil. Drag is the natural force of an object resisting movement through a fluid, like air. In order for an aircraft to fly, thrust must be equal to drag. So, the two rules that govern whether an aircraft is able to fly or not are thrust equals drag and lift equals weight. So, do you think you're ready to explain how this large 737-800 manages to fly? Follow along with me as I explain the aerodynamic forces acting on the 737 as it takes off. Notice right now how the aircraft is not flying, obviously. You can say that the lift generated by the wings is not equal to the weight. It is actually less than weight right now. However, once the aircraft taxis onto the runway and begins applying thrust, the relative wind, which is the wind passing over the airfoil, increases, thus producing a stronger lift effect. Okay, so the 737 is applying power, creating more thrust. Right now, thrust is greater than or equal to drag. However, lift is still less than weight at this point. With enough speed, the relative wind flying over the wings is beginning to create lift. While we begin to rotate, you'll notice that we are not quite lifting off the ground yet. This is because the lift force is not quite yet strong enough to get us off the ground. However, it doesn't take long after that point for lift to be greater than or equal to weight, therefore lifting us off the ground and getting this giant beast into the air.
I want to address this term stall, because you hear it in the press occasionally whenever they're dealing with accidents. And if you're in a car and the car stalls, what has happened?
The engine
is not working, right? The engine is not running. Well, that is not the same stall when we talk about aircraft wings. That's a whole other concept. So when we talk about stall in an aircraft, what we're talking about is taking the wing to a angle, which we call the critical angle of attack, in which the airflow is disrupted across the top of the wing. So we lose that low pressure, we lose that lift. And so when an aircraft stalls, the air across the top of the wing is disrupted and can no longer provide the lift required to overcome the weight, and now the aircraft becomes a paperweight. As soon as we change the angle of the relative wind to the wing and put it in this range, you can see we've got smooth flow. Then we recapture that lift, and this is a maneuver that we learn when we're learning to fly an airplane. We actually take it out and we stall it. And the aircraft is designed, if our center of gravity and everything is correct, the aircraft is designed to basically recover itself. You just turn loose to the controls. the aircraft will begin flying on its own. So with this backdrop, relative wind across the wing, a low pressure forms, we create lift. I'm going to turn it over to Helen, and she's going to give you some demonstrations of exactly what's going on there.
When they're talking about Bernoulli, who I'm sure was some happy Italian dude at one point, the little airplanes that you're going to see out at this airport are all going to have a curved wing like this. They're not going to have a flat wing. They're going to have a curvature over top of there. And the reason for the curve in there is because when air flows over top of a curved surface, it speeds up.
Sorry.
That speeding up of the air creates low pressure, which, for lack of a better term, sucks the wing upwards. Now, here's a really cool way of seeing that. Curved. Agree? Mm-hmm. Curved? All right. Curved. Agree? Curved? Mm. If I blow air between these two cans, what do you think the cans are going to do? I've got to go toward each other. If I blow air between these two cans, what do you think the cans will do? All right, we've got two togethers and one separate. And you're one of our students who ran here for check ride, so you're no fair to chime in there. All right, let's give this a try here. Let's actually bring that a little bit closer together. Cans are coming together. Mm-hmm. The reason that the cans come together is that when the air goes around this curved surface, it creates a low pressure zone, which draws these two cans together. And when you have a curved wing, whether it's your toy glider or the wing of a Cessna out here, or most any other small aircraft, you're going to see that curvature on the top so that it helps to create low pressure and bring the wing up. That's one of the ways that lift is created on an airplane. It's the way that everybody's taught initially in flight school. This is a flight school video. I tell you, I was so perplexed that by the time I finished my private pilot's license, because I kept going to air shows and watching airplanes fly upside down. And I knew very well that meant they should be sucked down towards the earth. So obviously, since air show planes do not get sucked towards earth, nor does the Air Force, or even the Navy, for that matter, there's obviously something else that's also going on to keep that from happening. When you start getting into really high performance aircraft, like your military aircraft and your air show performing airplanes, you're not going to see this curve. This curvature helps create lift there and make a wing more efficient. But it's not necessarily good for an airplane that wants to fly upside down. Who's made one of these before? Yep. They fly pretty good, right? No curvature needed, right? What you have on here is what's called angle of attack. When your airplane flies through the air, air is deflected off the bottom of the wing. That deflection of the air hitting the bottom of the wing and down creates lift. And that's a secondary source of lift on aircraft. And that's why your air show plane and your military planes can also fly upside down. They aren't just dependent on Bernoulli's effect over here. But your typical general aviation plane, it's got a little itty-bitty engine on it, because those pilots can't afford much in the way of gas. So with that, you're going to find that we're going to use everything we have going for us in order to create lift. We're going to have both angle of attack going for us, as well as this Bernoulli effect with this low pressure created in order to try to get hold that airplane up in the air. Now, what John was talking about over here with a stall, and we can actually stall this plane too. Would you agree this airplane can fly through the air like so pretty well? Yeah. I'm not going to throw it at you. You look like you're busy. but you think this airplane can fly through the air pretty well like so? No. At some point, that angle gets to a point where the air is not going to be able to flow over the wing. When you get to that point, you're not able to create lift. Catch, John. That was a pretty good flight, right? Yeah. Pretty straight. Now, what we can do with a couple little origami moves on this thing. Is that we can alter the plane to how it flies so that it is going to increase its angle of attack to the point where you're going to see the airplane is going to fly up and it starts trying to fly through the air like this. When that happens, though, it's unable to create lift and it's going to tip over and start coming back down. That's your aerodynamic stall. Oops. I guess I didn't do a very good job with that one. You're my. Let's get a little more aggressive with that, those control surfaces back there. There we go. Let's see if we can do that a little more aggressively back here. Let's see if we can do that. Yeah. Let's see if we can do a little more aggressive. You see how it went up and then pitched down? Here's a wing. We can't really move the airplane through the air, so we're going to move the air through the airplane. Check that out. Look at that air happily flowing over top of this wing. Everybody agree it's happily flowing over top of there? If you start pitching this airplane up, we are eventually going to get to a point where you can see how we're no longer blowing these telltales down here. When that happens, the air is no longer flowing over top of that wing. That's when you create that stalled condition. Now, with the way most modern airplanes are built, a stalled condition where the airplane is pitched up too violently in there will result in the airplane just automatically through aerodynamics, pitching back down and unstalling itself. Just like that paper airplane did. Pitched up and then pitched back down to unstall itself. But that's what John was talking about when it comes to stalls. Because you do hear about those sorts of accidents in the news where a pilot inadvertently, through poor airmanship, got the airplane into a stalled condition in there, which is normally very recoverable unless you're low to the ground. If you're low to the ground when it happens, you might not be able to have time before you impact a tree or something to be able to bring the nose back up. So when you hear about stalls in the news, that's generally what they're talking about, is that wing not creating the lift because of that angle of attack of that wing versus the air.
Just to review, we've got four forces. When we're in steady state, 1G flight, the lift equals the weight, and the thrust equals the drag. And everything is in balance. So how do we keep from stalling the airplane? We'll go through the flight controls and see what is happening out there on the wing and what's happening in the empennage. Ailerons are on the wing, and they operate just opposite one another. When one is up, the other's down. That gives us roll. Good. The nose of the airplane, that's roll. The nose of the airplane will yaw based on application of rudder. Yaw, there we go. And it will pitch, change pitch up and down as a function of the deflection of the elevator on the tail. So that's how we control her. So there is how an elevator control is rigged in a typical airplane. You see we've got cables. We'll either have cables or we'll have push rods that run back to the elevator. And as you can see, as you push forward, we get a downward deflection of the elevator, causes the tail to rise as the air makes contact with the surface, and the nose goes down. Conversely, if we want to climb, we pull back on the yoke or the stick, and just the opposite occurs. And that is pitch control. Aileron control, here via the cables. And as I indicated, you can see the little arrow here. If the control is moved in this direction, this aileron will go up, that aileron will go down, and the aircraft will roll to the left. You want to go to the right, move the yoke to the right, and you get just the opposite effect on the ailerons. Left movement, left aileron goes up, right aileron goes down, and just the opposite going back to the right. That's what we call roll control. And rudder is controlled with the feet, or yaw as Helen demonstrated. Push on the rudder pedal, deflect the rudder just like a boat, and the aircraft will yaw. Any questions? Okay. Left rudder, nose goes to the left. Right rudder, nose yaws to the right. Notice there, we're not talking about rolling now. We're talking about yawing the aircraft with the wings level. So if we talk about the axes, everything occurs around the center of gravity. We have a vertical axis, lateral axis, longitudinal axis, and everything moves about that those three axes. These are dual controls. Most of our aircraft have dual controls in them. Not all, but most. Move it to the right. You'll see that one also move to the right. They're connected together. This is the gas pedal. That changes the RPM of the engine and the propeller. These are flight instruments, radios, and your idiot lights that we have in a car. Those are your engine gauges. This is the latest and greatest now. This is the evolution. So we've gone from something pretty cluttered with a lot of what we call steam gauges, and we've now evolved to what we call glass. And all of those gauges now are displayed on electronic displays. And you have tremendous flexibility with them. You can see how simplified we've become with the controls. And this type of control is very natural. It doesn't take any time at all to get used to operating the aircraft with these side sticks. Move it to the left, you roll left, move it to the right, and then it moves in at fore and aft, provides a pitch control. You still have the rudder pedals down at the bottom. My favorite gauges are these three right here. Those are the old steam gauges, and they're backup gauges if the electronic system fails. Got keypads here that we can use to talk to these. We have an autopilot here. We have an audio panel here to control the audio. And there's your gas pedal there. Push it forward, you go faster. Pull it back, you reduce the RPM, and you reduce the power on the airplane. There's an interesting configuration. You've got two seats. You've got one seat here and one seat here. Got the stick in the middle. Either individual can fly the airplane, but only or two sets of rudder pedals. Anybody have any idea what these guys are?
Brakes.
Brakes. Yep. So we can control the brakes, and in most aircraft, we control them individually, left and right, for more positive control. And then if you want to get paid a lot of money to watch TV, you join these guys. Netflix comes up here, and internet surfing is here. So you take it and pull it out from here, and it pops right up. So we use the key set to communicate with the flight management system. And all of our publications now are displayed on these panels. So we've gone totally paperless. No paper in the airplane now. It's so all in it. Everything comes up there.
But you don't still carry paper as backup? Data link
from the company comes in through there, so you talk to the dispatchers and so forth via these. This is an A380. This is the largest passenger carrier airplane Airbus makes, manufactures it, and while you're operating on the ground and taxiing, you have cameras on the aircraft, so that you can see exactly where you are relative to coming into a gate and so forth, and clearing yourself. You can also use it in flight if you have something that an anomaly and you need to look at the airplane. You can scope out the airplane to see what may be going on there.
You mean like that gremlin on the wing?
Like the gremlin on the wing. There you go. The one flight control that we didn't talk about that I want to mention is trim. If you're familiar with boating, boats have trim tabs on the back of them where you can use to trim the boat for stability and get the right attitude out of the boat. The trim tab on an airplane is actually controlled, generally attached to a surface in some manner. In this case, this is an example of an aileron. And what that enables us to do is to take all of the pressures out of the controls, and the aircraft essentially flies itself. We call it a poor man's autopilot. And for Al getting ready to take his check ride, the airplane will pass the check ride for you. If you learn how to trim it and just let it do its thing, it'll work real hard for you. So We're not fighting, you know, much like your car. When your car is in proper alignment and so forth, there's not a lot of pressure when you're in cruise in your car, if you will. And airplanes are very stable. They're built that way. And when you get them properly trimmed up, they much prefer to fly themselves than have you manhandle them.
Kind of like a car after they invented power steering, wouldn't you think?
Very much like power steering. Yep. Yeah, that's a good analogy. So this is an example. This is a twin-engine airplane I was giving some instruction in, and we're doing a steep turn, 45 degrees angle of bank. You can see that's the horizon right there. So we're banked 45 degrees, and we're letting the airplane do this steep turn all by itself. Notice that he's flying the airplane. I'm instructing. He's flying the airplane. He's not touching the controls. And 45 degrees angle of bank in trim. Airplane will pass the check ride for you, Al.
We did that.
Did you?
Actually, with Dan and I.
Did you? With Dan?
Yeah. He was telling me, okay, let go, you know. And I was trimming a little and let go, and it actually did it.
Isn't that amazing? Yes. Yeah. This guy had never seen it before, and he's owned this airplane for a number of years. So that was a really fun instructional flight for me. Okay, let's review here. What do we have on the right wing, that little pointer? What do we call that? Aileron. Good. How about on the tail? Got a rudder. And what controls the pitch back there? The elevator controls the pitch. Good. Moving to the front of the airplane, we have the engine. Whoops, hit the wrong button. Got the engine, which provides the thrust. The propeller actually provides the thrust. The engine turns it, huh? Propeller. And let's see. You can have your choice of Reese's or Kit Kat. I've got one extra credit one because we didn't address that one, and it's on the wing, and Al can't answer this. Anybody know what that yellow? Did you want this? You really wanted this bad, I know. Yeah. And we use those to provide additional lift and drag. They do both for us. And we use them for any time we need to fly the aircraft slowly. Or we need to approach the ground at an angle that is normally steeper than cruise flight. It allows us to put the nose of the airplane over but not gain a lot of energy. And they're pretty handy to have, but they're not required. And lastly, I just want to touch on safety a bit. As I said, we're risk managers. This guy didn't do such a great job of managing risk on this day. I have a feeling, just looking at the weather, that he may have been searching for the ground in a cloud, and that tree popped right up in front of him before he realized what was happening. But we're always asked about, give us some statistics. As those of us who fly generally say, that the scariest part of flying airplanes is driving to the airport. If you can see, this is the latest data that I was able to get. 2012, we killed 33,000 folks in automobiles. I thought the home accidents was interesting. Falling off ladders, falling down the stairs, slipping in the shower, 18,000 people died just at home. Motorcycling, I almost would expect to see that higher than almost 5,000. Swimming, cycling, boating, and you can see general aviation is in 2012 fatalities is relatively low. We're constantly working to reduce that. I know you want some comparison. So what we do is we measure safety in terms of hundreds of thousands of hours flown. And we have a fatality, less than one fatality every 100,000 hours of operation of our general aviation fleet. The airlines is significantly lower than that. So the thing that concerns most people is, in your automobile, when the check engine light comes on or the engine stalls, you guide yourself over to the side of the road and you pull out your cell phone and call for help. When you're in an airplane, as I'll tell Al if I happen to give him his check ride, what you want to do is just keep pedaling, you know? We just got to keep pedaling in an airplane. But it's not, It's not a catastrophe when the engine does fail. We're trained to deal with that. Talking about jumping out of perfectly good airplanes, right? By the way, this is one of those, has anybody jumped out of an airplane with this type of operation? This guy right here has got a camera on his helmet, so he's videoing it. And this individual is strapped to this guy. So you heard George Bush jumping out of an airplane on his 90th birthday. This is the kind of thing, this would be exactly what he was doing. Just strap yourself to these guys and you free fall with them. Quite interesting. This aircraft built by Cessna has a turboprop engine in it. And I'm not sure how many jumpers it carries. Generally, it's about 12 people. But they pull all the seats out, and those jumpers are crazy. They'll all just cram together in there. And they'll load it up with jumpers. But occasionally, they have an engine fail on a jump plane. And this is an example of a jump plane returning to the airport without the engine. As you can see, the prop is stopped.
Where's he at?
In fact,
slow down.
In fact, what's really happening with this is that engine is actually running.
Yeah, but baby.
With that particular engine, it's not connected to the propeller, so you can actually feather the propeller and idle the engine. But that's.
Oh, where are all the jumpers?
Where are all the jumpers? Yeah. So. We're trained to handle those situations, and the outcome is generally very good. Just to talk about aircraft, you know, without engines, you know, there's gliders out there, and the gliders are towed and they're released. And this particular demonstration of glider flying is definitely unique and not the kind of thing that most glider pilots would get involved in. This is the Red Bull team, and what they're doing is this guy was in the back of this glider. They actually opened the canopy, and he climbed out onto the glider. They had mounted some handholds for him, and he climbed across the wing. So you can see him sitting on the wing. Now, this is an aircraft with no engine. And
typical pilots don't do this.
But it's fascinating to watch.
Had to butt walk his way out along the leading edge, but the real trick part is the forward somersault off the wing. Then comes a transfer. Ewald's number two, Kurt Tippy, slides from an echelon position to low line abreast position to snatch Steiner off the wing without A, kneecapping him, or B, squashing
him. But that's what an airplane will do without an engine, okay? We don't get that fancy. We just glide back to Earth and land the airplane at an airport, or we land it off field if there's not an airport
and then we get our cell phones
nearby.
Out.
And then we get our cell phones out. And there have been instances, and this is one, where an aircraft has lost both engines. They left Toronto in the middle of the night, going to Lisbon, Portugal. And they had 340 people on board this airplane, and they had a massive fuel leak. Very, very unusual. And when they were 65 miles from Lodges, an island in the Azores, both engines flamed out. And they glided in the middle of the night to the Lodges airport, and landed the airplane, and everybody walked away from it. So this is a highly, highly unusual situation. There have been a number of, a few of these kinds of things that have happened to airliners. Yes, sir?
Our height, what was their altitude?
They started at 37,000 feet, and the first engine flamed out, and the aircraft would not maintain altitude at 37,000 feet. So what they do is we call it drift down to an altitude that it the single engine can sustain it. And that was in the 28,000 foot range. And at 28,000 feet, 65 miles from Lodges, the engine failed. The second engine failed. So this guy, by the way, was a glider pilot.
So was he.
Yeah, so was this guy. Graduated from the Air Force Academy, learned to fly gliders at the Air Force Academy.
You're serious.
And, yeah.
We should call him up and invite him to get checked out to see, right?
Yeah, yeah, right. We all remember that. So, the engine fails, the airplane just doesn't fall out of the sky. It's just like rolling down a hill in your car. You've got all that kinetic energy built in, and use it to your advantage. And this is where we are now in light aircraft. If you get into a situation where you may be losing control of the airplane for whatever reason, you can pop a chute. And there have been numerous saves now by this ballistic chute system. The chute is mounted right here in a very thin panel, thin skin, if you will. And you reach up, pull a handle on the overhead, and there's a ballistics that fires, and it fires the canister out that has a chute in it. Yes, sir?
What is the airplane weigh?
That airplane is probably in the, 2,800 pound range is a guess.
These actually started on the other end of the spectrum. They started off with ultralights and hang gliders.
Yeah.
And then the larger aircraft companies such as Cirrus, you know, got involved with these. Young Eagles is a program that is run by the Experimental Aircraft Association. They're one of our big trade groups that we have. There's a couple large trade groups that represent pilots around the country. And the Experimental Aircraft Association primarily represents people who like to build those planes, like John was talking about, get planes in their garages and so forth. But also they represent a lot of people that just like to fly for fun and recreation. And this is one of the big programs that they sponsor, where they invite pilots from around the country to fly children. Actually, internationally, there are many other countries that are now participating in this program. And they provide insurance for those pilots that are flying, you know, their neighborhood kids out on flights and getting them up in the air. It's open for kids ages 8 through 17, and the program has flown over 1 million kids around the world. I think they're up to about 1.5 million kids. And this is something that the pilots from this airport participate with our local chapter of the Experimental Aircraft Association. We offer these flights as part of our Boy Scout and Girl Scout program we do in the spring, and also just the community and children at large in the fall.
You don't have to, just look at me, you don't have to be sharp to be able to fly an airplane. It's a matter of training. Anybody can do it. If you have the discipline and you have the motivation and you have the drive, anybody can do it. You can come out and talk to Helen at her flight school, and she'll take you out and throw you in an airplane. And within a very short time, you'll be amazed at how quickly you can learn to fly an airplane. It doesn't take anything special.
It just takes dedication. Yeah. You know? How much dedication has it taken for you, Al?
A lot.
Yeah. Flying an airplane is easy. Flying an airplane well takes dedication in there. Yeah. And as Al can attest, he's been working for a while now to get up to that level of proficiency that the FAA requires in their breed of pilots in there. You know, it does require that level of dedication. But, you know, coming out and flying and taking lessons, you know, there's no commitment required for coming out and having a good time and taking some lessons and deciding if you want to move on to that next step of becoming a pilot. It's a lot of fun. We always invite everybody to come on out and fly with us.
So the next program is on drones, right?
Yeah, next program's on drones. Tom McKnight, who was a former FAA, just retired last week, and he's been working with the FAA on the drone regulations for some time, and he's going to be coming out and talking to everybody about what you can and can't do with that drone that you got for Christmas. There's obviously been a lot of things in the news about them recently, some good, some not so good, but, you know, for better or for worse, drones are here to stay. I'm amazed every night when I turn on the evening news and I watch these camera angles that are, behind the news anchors in there that are obviously been, taken from a drone in there. Drones are going to be a part of what we see on television, for how television is done. It's going to be part of how real estate is done, how engineering is done, and they're here to stay, whether it's just for fun, little Johnny playing with his drone he got for Christmas, or commercial station or a network like ABC that's using it for the evening news. And Tom is going to be here to talk all about drones. We'd love to have you come on out for that.
Well, thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.